discussed a little bit on the effectiveness of the Bible quiz, participation that is there, and many other things. And we felt that, you know, we need to make some changes so that the participation level also improves. And we also get to learn, okay? It's a big opportunity. For instance, now 1 month down the line, we will be doing a quiz from 1 Chronicles. Normally, we would not have been studying a book like that, okay? But studying the book gives us an opportunity to learn that particular book in detail, okay? And we also looked at the possibility of, you know, many people who have the opportunity to share or minister from God's word, also taking up some good topics from the book we are studying, so that, you know, it will help in forming the background, or we will have a better understanding of that particular book. Okay. Then I think Linson also was suggesting that, you know, maybe each day some quiz point can be, a question can be given in the Bible study group or in the church group, so that, you know, people can respond and they can start learning some of the truths from that. Okay. And I think Sudha also posts a devotional every morning related to the book. But very important for each one of us to personally study each book, okay? Though the books like Chronicles and all may not sound interesting when you just look at the title, or even scan through the contents very quickly, you know, it may look as if it is not relevant to the modern Christian life, okay? But that's far from true, okay? The lessons that we can learn from this book are tremendous, okay? And I will encourage each one of us to read it, to study it, to meditate on it, to learn from it, and more than anything else, to apply from it, okay? As we study various aspects of the book, and also various people speak on this from this book, we will also get to learn many things personally, which we can apply in our lives, okay? But just by way of announcement, in the first set of quiz that was over, that is from January and February included, Brother Shaji's family has come out first, Linson's family has come second, and our family came third. But perhaps one of the reasons why these three have come forward is because we must have participated in all the quiz, okay? That is almost every week. There are many others who have participated only a few times and got proportionately very high marks in those things, okay? But of course, the important thing is not getting high marks, okay? Somewhere down the line, when during today's study, I will be also mentioning why we should study the Bible, okay? And it will help us to apply the truths. God is not going to check our memory, okay? So those of us who are setting the quiz also request you not to ask questions that are testing memory of people, okay? But rather the application of scriptures, okay? And something that will give a better understanding of scriptures, not to test, you know, the memory of people, okay? That is not the objective. And very often we think, you know, if we fail, it is a problem. People will know that I have failed, okay? But that's far from true. It is good for each one of us to know where we are, and so we must participate, okay? So while participating, I'm telling all this at the beginning, because sometimes as soon as the meeting is over, everyone exits, and so you will not be there to hear it. The quiz is open for almost 24 hours. You don't have to wait and participate in it. Though a specific time is being given, you need not wait and finish it at that time. Almost 24 hours are available for you to do the quiz. So if you're hungry and you need to cook, or you need to do your homework, or you need to do something, make sure that next morning or sometime very early, before early evening you finish the quiz, so you can be participating in that. Second thing, don't use names which cannot be recognized. Okay, creative seal, sometimes it may supply names like that for you, but it is good if you rename yourself and put it so we can keep track of the scores, and we would like to reward those who are taking effort to learn, effort to understand scriptures, apply it and memorize it so that they can be good. Remember, there are some good things that are mentioned about scriptures. In Timothy, we are told, no, Paul writing to Timothy says the scriptures are able to make you wise unto salvation. Okay, in other words, a person who studies scriptures can understand salvation better. Okay, it is intended to lead us into salvation. So whether we are big or small in the fraternity of God, it is good for us to memorize scriptures, to know it, to understand it, to apply it in our lives. Remember what David said also, your word have I hidden in my heart so that I may not sin against you. Okay, so the quiz that you take part of is not designed to test your this thing or give you high marks or low marks. Okay, we are not going to announce any scores. Okay, though we will be announcing winners so that we keep people motivated to participate, but at the same time, a winner may not necessarily enter heaven. A winner may not do necessarily well with respect to having a good and sound Christian life. Okay, because we need to apply it in our lives. Like David said, no, your word I have hidden in my heart so that I won't sin against you. Okay, so the application of scriptures, the remembering of scriptures to counter sin in our life is more important than the ability to recollect scriptures and reproduce it in the time of quiz. Okay, so the quiz in no way makes someone super spiritual as far as their Christian life is concerned. Person who does not get good marks in the quiz also is in no way poor in the eyes of the Lord. Okay. A person who might have just got one mark but has applied one truth in his life is far better than who got 10 out of 10 and applied nothing in his life. Okay, that's the message that I wanted to give before we go into phase two. Okay, we start with the marks from this week on. Linson will tabulate what was done on Tuesday can be dropped, and from today the scores can be kept, and request every single person to participate in it. Whether you get good marks or no, don't worry about it, but do participate so that you can grow in the Lord. Okay, 1 and 2 Chronicles. Okay, a brief overview, a brief introduction, a brief insight into some of the characteristics in the book so that we can read it and understand it. Okay, there are 3 steps in studying the Bible. I have taught this sometime back: observation, interpretation, and application. Okay, so scripture study must always be accompanied by sound observation, interpretation of what is difficult to understand and the conclusions that come from the observations. And if you have a good interpretation based on your observations that are there in the Bible, then you will be in a better position to apply the scriptures in your life. Okay, so today's introduction to the book of Chronicles is more or less an overview of some of the general observations that are there in this book. So as a result of those general observations, it will help you to understand the book of Chronicles better. It will give you a better insight into interpreting the book, and therefore it will help you to apply the scriptures in a better way. Okay, and we may be able to put ourselves in the context of the people who are recipients of this book, or who are the first readers of the book, direct readers of the book. Okay, when we fit ourselves into their shoes, we will understand how the scriptures that were relevant to those people at that time become relevant to us as well. Okay, in the originals, the book of 1 and 2 Chronicles was a single book. Okay, I had made a mention of it when we did a brief look at 1 and 2 Kings and 1 and 2 Samuel. Okay, these are all single books in the original Hebrew Bible. Okay, the division was made because they were big books. When the Greek translation of the Old Testament was made before the time of Christ, that version, the Greek version, was called the Septuagint, because 70 Bible scholars sat together and translated the Hebrew Aramaic Bible into the Greek, which was at that point of time, that is in the time just prior to the coming of the Lord, was the language of the spoken language across the world, because the Greek Empire had spread to all the known world at that time. Okay, and later on, when the Greek Empire fell also, and the Roman Empire came, much of the language remained in circulation. Okay, so the influence of the Greeks was there. So the Septuagint came as a Greek translation. Okay, then maybe someone can read Luke chapter 11 verse 51. Some Bible verses I'll refer to. Please read it quickly, whoever finds it.
हाबिल की हत्या से लेकर जकरिया तक, जकरिया की हत्या तक, जो वेदी और मंदिर के बीच में घात किया गया, मैं तुमसे सच कहता हूँ, इन सब का लेखा इसी समय के लोगों से लिया जाएगा।
Okay, can someone read 2 Chronicles chapter 24 verse 20 and 21 also? 2 Chronicles chapter 24 verses 20 and 21.
तब परमेश्वर का आत्मा यहोयादा याजक के पुत्र जकरिया में समा गया, और वह ऊंचे स्थान पर खड़ा होकर लोगों से कहने लगा, परमेश्वर यों कहता है कि तुम यहोवा की आज्ञाओं को क्यों टालते हो? ऐसा करके तुम्हारा भला नहीं हो सकता। देखो, तुमने तो यहोवा को त्याग दिया है, इस कारण उसने भी तुमको त्याग दिया। तब लोगों ने उसके विरुद्ध द्रोह की गोष्ठी करके राजा की आज्ञा से यहोवा के भवन के आंगन में उस पर पथराव किया।
ओके, सो व्हाई आर वी लुकिंग एट दिस पैसेज राइट नाउ, यू नो द पैसेज व्हिच वाज कोटेड बाय द लॉर्ड, बिकॉज़ इट फॉल्स इन द बुक ऑफ 2 क्रॉनिकल्स। ओके, इन द हिब्रू बाइबल द बुक ऑफ क्रॉनिकल्स was the last book of their Bible. Okay, it was not the book of Malachi, but it was the book of, it was not arranged in the sequence that we have in our English Bibles today. It had a different arrangement, the Pentateuch, that is the 5 books that Moses wrote, the prophets, then the poetry, okay, and the historical books of Samuel, Kings and Chronicles. Okay, so the Chronicles was the last book in the Jewish Bible. Okay, now when Jesus referred to how from the blood of Abel to the blood of Zechariah, who was martyred between the altar and the sanctuary, okay, that is the brazen altar and the sanctuary, that is in the courtyard, he was martyred. So the first martyr of the Bible, Abel, to the last martyr of the Old Testament, as it was in our Lord's time, okay, as it was arranged in the Lord's time, okay, that portion the Lord recognized as God's word. Okay, it is God, it is our Lord authenticating the Old Testament as scripture completely from Genesis to Chronicles. I mean, not in the sequence that we have, but in the sequence it was arranged at that time. in the old book. All the 39 books that we have in the Old Testament were part of the books that were there, recognized by the Lord at that time. It is also an important thing because in the Roman Catholic Bible, you will find that there are some more books which are recognized as another 11 books are recognized as the part of the Old Testament canon. Okay, so this particular verse in Luke 11:51 by Jesus making that statement is a very apparent reason that to indicate that those other books which many others add as scriptures are not really scriptures. Okay, so books like Maccabees and others from which the Jews, from which the Roman Catholics get the concept of purgatory is not part of scriptures. From the blood of Abel, the first martyr, to the blood of Zechariah, the last martyr of the Jewish canon, okay, that the Lord recognized as scripture. Okay, then subsequent to the time of our Lord Jesus Christ, subsequent to his earthly life, the New Testament, the 27 books were written down. Okay, and they were recognized as part added to the canon later on. Okay, the Hebrew title for this book, Dibre Hayamin, simply means the annals or events. Okay, the Septuagint used a name, things omitted. Okay, that was the title that was given. That means there were a lot of things which were omitted by kings and Samuel, which got added in the book of Chronicles. That is what the Septuagint translators meant when they put the title there. Okay, but the original word title means simply annals or events. Okay, and the book of Chronicles, the word Chronicles came from the Latin Vulgate, which was a translation in Latin, which was done in the New Testament times. Okay, there is no direct quotation of this book in the New Testament. Okay, that is something that we must know. Okay, but it doesn't lessen anything. Very significant book, very important book. And like that mention that was made, things omitted. There is almost 53% additional stuff in the book of Chronicles as compared to Samuel and Kings. That is, that much more extra material is there, which is not there in Samuel and not there in Kings, which you can find in the book of Chronicles. So it throws a lot of light on the previous two books which we have studied together. Okay, there are almost 70 speeches which are quoted extra in the books of Chronicles. Okay, then who wrote it? The book does not claim the name of the author. Okay, tradition of the Jews indicates that it could be Ezra or a little bit of Ezra and Nehemiah together. Okay, most people believe that it was Ezra, looking at the style, the time of writing, and so on and so forth. Okay, but whatever it was, this particular book gives, when you survey it, you know, when you have a rapid reading of the book, one of the indications that will come very clearly is that it is a very well referenced book. Okay, that is, the author had painstakingly studied the writings which were there in his time, okay, available in his time in the form of scrolls, and he made notes from it and compiled it meticulously in an orderly fashion, okay, in order to achieve a particular purpose. Okay, because it is an extensive work, so he has done an excellent work, and he has compiled it in a particular way. So it's very important for us to understand what he took into the book, what he dropped, and so we get a better idea of what the author was wanting to communicate to the readers to whom it was directly written. Okay, for instance, right through this book, if you see 1 Chronicles chapter 29 or 2 Chronicles 29, 29. Can someone read it? Sorry, I think it is 1 Chronicles 29, 29. Huh?
आदि से अंत तक राजा दाऊद के सब कामों का वृत्तांत और उसके राज पर पराक्रम का और उस पर और इज़राइल पर वरन देश देश के सब राज्यों पर जो बीता इसका भी वृत्तांत समूएल दर्शी और नातान नबी और गाद दर्शी की पुस्तकों में लिखा हुआ है।
ओके, सम ऑफ दीज राइटिंग्स आर नॉट देयर विद अस टुडे। ओके, he says that the events in King David's reign from beginning to end, they are written in the records of Samuel the seer, the records of Nathan the prophet, and the records of Gad the seer. Okay, Gad the seer and Nathan the prophet, their writings are not there with us. They must have been there when the chronicler wrote it down. Okay, in a similar fashion, he quotes from the book of Isaiah also in 2 Chronicles 26, 22, and in in chapter 27 verse 24 he refers to the book of the annals of King David. Then he, in 2 Chronicles 9:29, those who want to write it can write it down, the writings of Ahijah the Shilonite, Iddo the seer is mentioned in 2 Chronicles 9:29, and the writings of Shemaiah the prophet in 2 Chronicles 12:13. Okay, so in other words, this particular writer took great pains to research. Just last on Tuesday when we were looking at kya padega in 1 Chronicles, you know, nearly a third of the book seems to be genealogy. Okay, so who can write a genealogy well? Only someone who has studied and someone who is sure and someone who had authentic information of genealogy. And remember, he traces the genealogy from the time of Adam to that time. Okay, so very extensive work, very remarkably done, and it has a purpose. Okay, and what is that purpose? Now, when was this author writing it? He quotes the last verse in 2 Chronicles. Can someone read it? 2 Chronicles last verse. Or rather, sorry, verse 22, you can read it. 2 Chronicles 36, 22. Someone keep the finger in 1 and 2 Chronicles, so you'll find it easier to turn it.
पारस के राजा कुसरू के पहले वर्ष में
यहोवा लिटिल लाउडली ब्रदर
पारस के राजा कुसरू के पहले वर्ष में यहोवा ने उसके मन को उभारा कि जो वचन यिर्मयाह के मुंह से निकला था वह पूरा हो, इसलिए उसने अपने समस्त राज्य में यह प्रचार करवाया और इस आशय की चिट्ठियां लिखवाई।
सो द ऑथर एंड्स with the proclamation made by King Cyrus, okay, to set the Jewish captives free. Somewhere in the middle, he also mentions in the genealogy about some of the people we had read when we had studied the book of Zechariah, you know, Zerubbabel and Shealtiel and all these people, okay. They are also mentioned. So it is obvious that the writer was writing after the Jews returned from exile or Babylonian captivity. Okay. And Cyrus's edict was in 538 BC. Okay. But if you see the genealogy of Shealtiel and Zerubbabel is mentioned for another 5-6 generations down. So perhaps very close to 400 to 425 BC, that would have been the time, you know, around 450 to 425 BC would have been the time when this author wrote it down. Very much close to the time of Ezra. That is why many people look at the style, look at the contents, and feel that it is Ezra who might have written. Whether it is Ezra or not, it was someone who was as careful, as meticulous like him. And the book is written in that context, a returning diaspora, a population that is discouraged, beaten up, and not knowing where they are in that sense, you know, in the eyes of God, that kind of a people this book is written to. Okay, so there are some reasons why the author is writing it. Some of the questions in the minds of the people would have been, has God abandoned us? Okay, there was a time of prosperity in Israel, then came the defeat, okay, sin and defeat, and now they return back into Jerusalem from captivity with almost every place in shambles. The temple in ruins, the city walls broken, and practically nothing to be grown. It was a disaster. Everything was wild after 70 years of captivity. Okay, and they must have been wondering, does God still have a plan for our lives? Okay, has God abandoned us? Okay, are we still God's chosen or special people? These worries would have been there. So the author, through every action that is there, through every word, tries to encourage this kind of people to make them feel fit into God's plan. Okay, this book should encourage us if we have fallen, we have slipped spiritually also, we have backslidden and gone away, and we have felt the punishment of God in our lives. Things were good in our lives, we backslid, and now things are not good. You know, our family life is disturbed, our peace is gone, we had a good job, we were careless, we were lazy, we were disobedient, we were reckless, and we lost our job or lost our promotion or whatever else might be in our life. You know, we didn't study well, we didn't get good marks, whatever could be the reason that might make us feel low and down. When you read this book, you can get encouragement. Okay, the very purpose for which this author wrote it was to encourage the people and tell them that God still has a plan. So very meticulously he weaves this book into a strand, a story, so that they can understand it. Okay, so the first thing, there are 7 points we will look at quickly. The first point is the continuity that he proclaims in God's plan. Okay, so that they will be able to understand they were part of that plan that God had. In chapter 9, verse 1, he talks about captivity. Verse that we saw talked about the edict to bring them back. And if you look at the genealogy, it starts with Adam. It comes down to Noah. Methuselah is there, Noah is there, Abraham is there, Isaac is there, Jacob is there, and so on, right up to David and David's descendants, and so on and so forth. Okay, a beautiful picture is there, and right up to the time when the captives returned, even people who are returning from captivity, they are mentioned as descendants of that same line. Okay, so what does the author want them to know? They were part of that plan which started in the Garden of Eden. Okay, if you read the book of Hebrews chapter 11, you will find a hall of faith or a list of people who excelled in faith, who became examples of faith from the Old Testament is mentioned. Okay, and it is written to the New Testament believers. Okay, to indicate that many people who believed, who suffered, who died, who were martyred, who were thrown into fire, sawn into two, thrown to wild beasts, okay? Some who were from the New Testament times, who were actually digging holes and living underground, okay? In Rome, there are many catacombs, that is underground tunnels, where Christians used to be buried, and these also became the living places of close to one or two generations of Christians who faced intense persecution from the time of Nero and thereafter. Okay, some Christians were born underground and lived underground as well. Okay, and Hebrews talks about people who lived underground, dug holes and went inside. Okay, and he connects right from the Old Testament believers who suffered. He connects that famous line of faithful people, believing people, to the New Testament times as well. In the same way, this writer to the Chronicles connects right from the creation story till the time of their return from exile and draws it into one whole picture. That is why such a big genealogy is given, so that the Jews understood that they are part of God's plan and God had not abandoned them without a cause. Okay, so that is the first thing that we need to know. The second thing was God's special place for the Jewish people, that he wanted to emphasize. So the genealogy and the stories that were picked up, okay, or the events that were picked up by the author to connect into a stream, they form a story. Okay, they have a special way of narrating which the author uses. Okay, they are used to emphasize that the Jews are a special people. Okay, in the chapter 15 verse 2 of 1 Chronicles, we are told that the Levites were a chosen people by God. Okay, in chapter 28 verse 4, we are told that David was chosen by God to be king over Israel. In chapter 28 verse 6 of 1 Chronicles, we are told that Solomon, his son, not the eldest son of King David, but Solomon was chosen by God to be king after David and also to build the temple of the Lord. Okay, in other words, God was directly active in his choice of people, in his selection of people, and his driving of history as it unfolded. Okay, in 2 Chronicles chapter 6 verse 6, we are told that Jerusalem was chosen by God, okay, to be a place where God's name will be there. In other words, God's address. So if people wanted to meet God and understand who he was, then that was a place to look forward to when the temple was there. Okay, so God had made a choice about Jerusalem. Okay, Trump did not choose, God chose. Then 2 Chronicles 7:12 talks about God's choice of the temple as the place where sacrifices will be offered, which will be accepted to God in the Old Testament. Okay, so the author makes specific mention of things that were selected and chosen by God so that the Jews who are returning from captivity would know that they were part of God's special program. Okay, and they were part of the whole picture. Okay, then Romans chapter 9 verses 1-5. Can we turn in our Bibles to Romans chapter 9? I'll read it in English. I speak the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience confirms it through the Holy Spirit. I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart, for I could wish that I myself were cursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my people, those of my own race, the people of Israel. Theirs is the adoption to sonship. Theirs is the divine glory, the covenants, the receiving of the law, the temple worship, and the promises. Theirs are the patriarchs, and from them is traced the human ancestry of the Messiah, who is God over all, forever praised. Amen. Okay. Paul took this and connected beyond what the chronicler is doing to the time of the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay. The chronicler brought the connection up to their time. Paul brings the connection of the Jews right up to his time and tells them, what a pitiable state you are in when you don't believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, we Jews, you know, were the ones who were chosen by God to be specially adopted by God. Okay, and we had the beautiful covenants and the temple worship. The law was given, the promises were given, and the patriarchs, that is Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, they all belong to that. And through the lineage of David came the earthly lineage of the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, so very similar way Paul is connecting history and bringing it into one whole picture for the Jews. Okay, and here the chronicler makes it very clear for them to understand. The third point that we we can learn from this book is listen to God's word, listen to his preachers or prophets. Okay, there is an exhortation in the Chronicles to listen to the example or the exhortation being given directly by God and by his prophets, who are his mouthpieces in communicating God's word. Not to look at kings as examples. Okay, that's what it seems to be saying. Okay, Second Chronicles chapter 16 verse, Second Chronicles chapter 20 verse 20. Here King Jehoshaphat is talking like this. Listen to me. Okay, have faith in the Lord your God. Okay, and you will be upheld. Have faith in his prophets and you will be successful. In other words, God, as God's mouthpieces, listen to them. Okay, this is a king telling. Okay, because many followed the sayings of their kings and were led astray. There were problems with them. Okay, and right through, there are some beautiful verses. Okay, Second Chronicles chapter 16 verse 9. We can treat it as a memory verse. We have learnt it before. Can someone read it? Second Chronicles chapter 16 verse 9.
देख, यहोवा की दृष्टि सारी पृथ्वी पर इसलिए भिड़ती रहती है कि जिनका मन उसकी ओर निष्कपट रहता है उनकी सहायता में वह अपनी सामर्थ्य दिखाए.
Okay, the eyes of the Lord range throughout the earth to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to him. Okay, this is what the Lord told Asa the king. Okay, so God was intervening directly in history. He was intervening directly in people's lives. And he was speaking through his prophets as he speaks through God's servants even today. Okay, as he speaks through his word even today, through the Bible to each one of us. Okay, we are encouraged to listen to the messages that we are being given. We are encouraged to study God's word and listen to his voice. And what is God doing on his part? His eyes are scanning the earth to see whose heart is fully devoted to him, so that he can strengthen that person, so that he will not fall. And in case of Asa, who had been a good king till that time, who was led, who did a disastrous thing at that point of time in his life, the Lord tells, you have done a foolish thing by turning to your own heart, to your own counsel, to wrong advice, rather than listening to what the prophet said, rather than listening to what God was telling through them. Okay, so listen and act. That is the third message that we have in the book of Chronicles. I'm just giving you the tip of the iceberg sort of a thing. If you read through the entire book, there are many life stories which are mentioned, each with a message. Okay, each with something to warn us about. Don't be like this, be like this, whatever it might be. Learn and you will understand it. The fourth point, sin and disaster are closely related. Okay, so in the book of 2 and 2 Chronicles, the chronicler identifies or connects the sin of the Jewish people or the Israelites and the people of Jerusalem as the one that led them into captivity. Okay, something that made them fall. Okay, that is something in 1 Chronicles chapter 28 verse 9. You can see David's advice to King Solomon, or Solomon his son. Can someone read it? 1 Chronicles 28:9.
हे मेरे पुत्र, सुन, मन, तू अपने पिता के परमेश्वर का ज्ञान रख और खरे मन और प्रसन्न जीव से उसकी सेवा करता रहे, क्योंकि यहोवा मन को जांचता और विचार में जो कुछ उत्पन्न होता है उसे समझता है। यदि तू उसकी खोज में रहे तो वह तुझको मिलेगा, परंतु यदि तू उसको त्याग दे तो वह सदा के लिए तुझको छोड़ देगा।
Okay, so what is the lesson that David, after his lifetime of experience before his death, wants to tell his son? He is telling, my son Solomon, acknowledge God of your father and serve him with wholehearted devotion and with a willing mind. Okay, not out of compulsion, not because the church leaders are digging or asking you, not because your mother or father is telling you to, not out of any kind of compulsion, but because you wish to. Okay, for the Lord searches every heart. Okay, God is looking at different people's hearts, why they are doing what they are doing. We may look at outward actions and be happy with it, but God searches the thoughts and the reasons behind each action. Okay, and if you seek him, he will be found by you, but if you forsake him, he will reject you forever. Okay, this is the message of the book of Chronicles. It is an essay on how God accepts people and how God rejects and abandons them. So if people find themselves in distress and trouble and feel that God has abandoned them, it is of their own doing. They have chosen to move away from God, and so God has left them to their choice. Okay. Fifth thing, no tribe of Israel is lost. Okay, there are many famous books, and if you read in the internet, you will find lot of things. The lost tribes of Israel. Okay, many books have been written. Also, there are cults. Armstrongism. I think it is the Church of God or something like that. It is called. Worldwide Church of God. These are cults which specialize using genealogies. Okay, and they try to proclaim as if the white population is the missing 10 tribes of Israel. Okay, so when you read the book of Chronicles, one thing you will realize beyond doubt is no tribe of Israel was lost. Okay. Babylonian captivity did not result in loss of tribes or their tribal identities. That was not the place where it happened. I'll just give a few examples. 1 Chronicles chapter 9 verse 2. Can someone read it? Quickly, yeah? We are running out of time also.
बंधुआई से लौटकर जो लोग अपनी अपनी निज भूमि अर्थात अपने नगरों में रहते थे, वे इजरायली याजक, लेवीय और मंदिर के सेवक थे।
ओके, ऑल इजराइल, हु इजराइल, इजराइल इज द नॉर्दर्न पार्ट, वाज लिस्टेड इन द जीनियोलॉजीज रिकॉर्डेड इन द बुक ऑफ किंग्स ऑफ इजराइल एंड जूडा। ओके, Israelites were also listed in the list of the kings of Israel and Judah. They were taken captive. They, including Israel, where they were taken captive to Babylon because of their unfaithfulness. There were a lot of northern people who had settled in the southern kingdom. Okay. And they were also taken captive because the northern kingdom went into captivity in 722 BC, and it was another 110 years later that the southern kingdom was ransacked. The northern kingdom was taken by the Assyrians, the southern by Babylon. But when the north was invaded by Assyria, many people migrated into the southern kingdom from Israel. Their genealogies were maintained. That means if genealogies are maintained, that means their identities were preserved. Their clannish identities were preserved. That is why the writer in the Chronicles is actually detailed writing about all the tribes and giving their details. Okay. Chapter 9 verse 3. From Judah, Benjamin, Manasseh, Ephraim. These people who lived in Jerusalem. So at least 5 tribes are mentioned about people living in Jerusalem. Okay. Their movements before the captivity are also mentioned in 2 Chronicles chapter 11, verse 11, we are told the Levites during Rehoboam's reign, they migrated to the south, that is to the kingdom of Judah. Then people from Ephraim and Manasseh, they migrated after the Assyrian invasion in 2 Chronicles chapter 30 at the invitation of King Hezekiah. This is there in 2 Chronicles 15:9 and 2 Chronicles 30. And at Hezekiah's time during the great Passover celebration, which is mentioned in 2 Chronicles chapter 31 verse 6. So there was a lot of migration of the northern kingdom into the south before they were taken captive into Babylon. So when the remnant returned, okay, what I'm trying to say, please understand, when the remnant returned back from Babylon into Jerusalem and inhabited that area, it was not only the southern tribes, it included a mixture of people both of north and south. It was a total remnant of Israel, the descendants of Jacob, okay, who returned back from captivity, okay. And anyone remembers any tribe which is mentioned in the New Testament? Any person belonging to a particular tribe in the New Testament?
Dan is missing.
Brother, I can't hear.
Dan,
yeah.
Tribe Dan.
Dan is not mentioned in Revelation.
Revelation 7.
Yeah. Okay. Any person mentioned with a particular thing? Remember the Lord when he was taken to the temple? Who met him? Anna. Remember? From the tribe of?
Okay.
Asher.
Asher.
Okay. Of the tribe of Asher. So people were knowing their identities, and it was not only the southern tribe. Anna was from the tribe of Asher. Okay. So all these theories that people put forward. So if you read the Bible, you will know that they are wrong. If you don't read the Bible, if even things like genealogy is not important to us, then we can get sidetracked by people who deceive and enjoy that kind of a thing. Okay. There are speeches, the sixth thing. There are speeches that are found in the book of Samuel, in the book of Chronicles, which is not found in Samuel and Kings. There are totally 165 speeches, out of which 95 of them are there in the previous two books, and 70 are unique to the book of Chronicles. Okay, like Abijah's speech, Asa's speech, Jehoshaphat's speech in 2 Chronicles 13, 14, and 20. Okay, these are things I don't have time for us to look at that. Okay. Then the seventh thing that I want you to see is the characteristic. This is one of the important things I want you to look at before we wind up for today. The author paints a beautiful picture in the book of Chronicles of his ancestors. Okay. So while he connects them to their time, okay, through genealogy, then he picks on the life of David and the life of Solomon. These are the key figures who are there in the book. In the first Chronicles, it is David's life. In second Chronicles, the key player would be Solomon and the kings who followed from Judah. The kings of Israel are noticeably dropped. Okay, why? Because he did not want them to remember the Israelite kings. They were worthless. They were idolaters. They were pagan worshippers. Okay. And they led the entire population into sin. Okay. And so the author does not dwell on the kingdom of Israel, the northern kingdom at all. The southern kingdom also had its share of bad kings, but it also had its share of some good kings who brought revival and restored the worship in the temple, and the priestly worship and sacrifices and so on and so forth. Okay. David and Solomon are idealized. They are made like supermen. Okay. Their sins are omitted. Okay. In other words, Bathsheba is not mentioned. David murdering Bathsheba's husband does not find any mention. Absalom's rebellion does not find a place. Amnon's death does not find a place. Shimei's rebellion and cursing does not come here. Okay? Only the census is mentioned, which David took, which was wrong. Okay? But it has a special place. That is why it is mentioned. Okay? I have quoted that many times, Second Chronicles mein. It connects the mountain of Moriah, where last week only, you know, twice we were reminded of Genesis 22, where Abraham offered his son as a sacrifice, and the place where the temple was built later on, the place where after the census, the judgment stopped, where the angel of death stopped, was a field of Arona. Okay, and in exactly that same place, David buys the plot, which becomes the place where the temple is built, and somewhere on the mountains there in Moriah is where our Lord was crucified. Okay, because of the significance of the place, that particular census is mentioned. But otherwise, all bad acts that David and Solomon committed are not mentioned. Solomon's multiple wives are not finding a mention. His affinity for heathen women. Okay, princess from other countries, they don't find a mention. His fall into idolatry is not mentioned. Okay, but they are presented as good, powerful examples of a messianic king who would follow, you know, who would be not having the wrongs which they had. Okay, these earthly messianic prototypes had flaws, but the Messiah who would come would not have those flaws. Okay, that is the message that he tries to push through. Okay, then I think we will end with that, and we can enjoy studying God's word together right through this time. In your personal study also, you can study 1 Chronicles. Maybe shortly Linson will announce how many chapters we can study after we have a look at it. But do begin your studies. Observation, interpretation, application. What I helped you to do is take a cursory observation on the surface, so that you know you get a good little bit of interpretation from that. By observing, you could observe some things are there, some things are missing, and you could have some interpretation based on it. That interpretation helped us to apply scriptures, okay, in our lives. So every passage that is studied, every quiz that is conducted, all the quiz masters, please note, application is the most important thing. So ask questions that will help people recall, remember, and apply scriptures in their lives. Okay, recall, remember, and apply scriptures in their lives. Okay, we will close with that.